Amen. What a great day it is. Even if it was snowing, it's a great day. No? You can't hear me?
Oh.
What?
You're on, but keep going. You're good.
Okay. One says I'm on, the other says I'm off. Most people say I'm off. Amen. You know, guys, our job as Christians is to witness to the world about our Savior. Just like a hunter wouldn't go out to hunt without his rifle, we need to be equipped whenever we're out there to give an account of this hope that we have. This is the Word of God. This is what God wrote for us to teach us how to live this Christian life. There's nothing left out that we need to know. I couldn't care less when Jesus had the flu. Ain't gonna help me serve my master any better. I don't care when he had the mumps, when he had an upset stomach. God wrote in here what I need to know to be victorious in this life. And if it ain't in here, I don't need to know it. And there's all kinds of other books that are written and all kinds of stuff to take our mind off of what God wrote. Study the genuine. Study the genuine. Not mere man's opinion of the genuine. Study the genuine. When I leave this property, you guys know about the bulletins we have. Not bulletins, they're this is the Who is Welcome pamphlet that we put together to give people. You don't have to be an evangelist or anything else to hand this to somebody, because there's a lot of humor in it and it'll make them smile. I gave one the other day to a lady working at McDonald's, and she ended up showing it around to all the other employees. But I'm dead serious about what's in it. This is a great tool for us to be using out there. Some people don't have the wherewithal to come up cold turkey and witness. The great thing is, guys, is we can hand them a little piece of paper. Said, you're going to love this. Don't read this when you're driving, because you'll die laughing, literally. A major tool for us. Guess what? National statistics say that 6% of church growth is signage. The signs out in front. 6% of the growth in the congregation comes from the media. 85% comes from members inviting people. How are we doing? How are we doing, man? We need to care deeply about those out there who are lost. We need to be driven to share with them the truth. And that's what I love about this church, man. We love each other here, you know. We don't put no phony facade up. We don't get dressed up in suits. Well, sometimes we do. But at the original church in Anaheim, the set-free church there, somebody wore a tie, they cut it off in the middle. We're just about being regular. God knows what we look like when we're butt naked, man. Who are we trying to impress? Let's just be real. 7 days a week, you know, 7 days a week. God knows how I look in the morning when I stand in front of the mirror. I can hardly bear to look at it myself. You know, I said, my gosh, look at this white-headed dude. You know, I mean, but you know what? Jesus doesn't even see that. And we have all of these preconceived notions about how we should dress or look. You know, there's one thing that nobody knows what Jesus looked like. But show me a picture somewhere or of Jesus in a crew cut. You know, I mean, people don't think he looks like that. And yet, people nowadays think that if you don't look like that, there's something wrong with you. You know. I want to tell you, man, we are just regular folks. We're just regular folks that don't want anybody else to go to hell. It's God's desire that none perish, but that all would come to repentance. It's my desire, too. And it needs to be a burning desire inside each and every one of you. That our mission out there is to seek out the lost. Seek it out. You know, I mean, where do lost people go? All kinds of places out there, man. Well, you can't go in there because you're a Christian. Really? Who'd Jesus hang out with? The likes of me? Don't be afraid, but don't go alone. Accountability is the key. And so, today I want to share with you about this amazing thing that we have. Every born-again believer has got the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of you. Our minds can't hardly wrap around that. You know? But that's what the Bible says. I'll show you today in the Word. And so no matter where we are, God is not only watching, but he is in us, telling us what we need to say. I love talking to people out there. I've got all kind of ways of breaking the ice, you know, making them laugh. Scripture says the joy of the Lord is our strength. You know, I want to be strong. I want you to be strong, and I am bound and determined to give you what you need to be successful in the eyes of God in reaching this lost world. And you know, what's really amazing is around the world is being impacted by this little church, the Orsorto family, going out to other countries and loving people in the name of the Lord. How cool is that? And we're all over the world on the internet. How cool is that? Oh, again, I want to tell you guys, if you want to get your face on the internet, get up and walk to the back of the church during service. If you've got any warrants, anything, you know, international warrants, they're going to see you. Some of you come from a background that means something to you. You know, there was a time many years ago when we needed a new stove for the kitchen. And so I put it, oh, my car parts are coming. I put it on our sign out there, good used stove wanted. It was up there for a month. One day this guy pulled in a fancy car, got out of it, and walked from the car to the here in a suit and tie. I go, surely they haven't found something 40 years old that they're gonna come arrest me on. You know, come on, man, you know. And he said, I've been looking at that sign for a month and I've been convicted every time I go by it. And so he gave me a Home Depot card for $500 and he said, go buy a stove. Wow. The stove was $506. Wow. I was willing to help. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. Yeah, we'll make this work. Isn't it amazing how God takes care of his kids? You know? We didn't have the money for a stove. but we had the desire and we were using that to feed God's people. Come on, man. Sunday after service is my favorite time of the week when we get to sit across the table from each other and sometimes even say the things in our lives that we're hurting with, you know. Those who are saved have what they need on board to be a witness for God, an ambassador for Christ. That means we represent Him. We don't represent ourselves. I don't post selfies. It ain't about me. About Him. My whole life has got to be about Him. Is there anybody that does not have a bulletin? We're all good? Okay. Our counselor, the Holy Spirit. That is our counselor. Not in addition to a carnal man. If the Holy Spirit is living in us, we need to be in tune with that Spirit. And it's sad that even Scripture tells us that we don't listen. You know? Any of you ever not listened? Other than me, I'm the only one. Saturday morning breakfast, Golden Corral in Gainesville. Try to come. We have a great time, you know. And we're doing my favorite thing, eating. You know. And I can talk and eat with my mouth full. I know you're not supposed to do that, but I get it down. And Thursday at Nancy's house, the women's Bible study group meets. What time do you meet there? 10:30. 10:30. So if you have any extra words you need to speak, go there. and you can speak them. Okay. My wife comes back spent. There's no words left. She spoke them all. Okay. Open your bulletins. Isn't Scripture good? You know, there's no mistakes in the Bible. God would not allow something to go in there that's not true and expect us to live by it. All this stuff, this interpretation stuff, that's just men's desire to move Scripture around to what they want to believe. It is what it is. It says it plain and clear. So, the Spirit in us. Let's try to get a grip on what that means when God indwells us. Because we can't do this Christian life on our own. We can't do this thing. In John 14, 15 and 17, it says, if you love me, if is a huge word. Do you guys know that if is a big word? If. Everything hinges on if. If you love me, you will obey what I command. We could just go ahead and stop, put the tables up, and have lunch. That's it. If you love him, you will obey him. That's the Bible. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. See, Jesus was going away. And so we need a counselor, right? We're just floundering out there without one. The Spirit of Truth. You know that it's a contradiction for a Christian to lie because he's indwelled by the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him. Unsaved people cannot accept the Holy Spirit. Can't. That's what the Bible says. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. Unsaved people don't know God. They'll talk about it, but what does the Bible say? It's all that matters. But you know him, Christian. For he lives with you and will be in you. You guys ever heard of the prayer of Jabez? Talks about expanding your territory. I quit praying that prayer because I went from a 32 to a 40 waist. Expanded my territory. The joy of the Lord's our strength, guys. We can't be something that others don't want to be. We go out there looking like we've been baptized in lemon juice. Who would want to be like that? We should be happy. What could take away your joy? You're going to heaven, Christian. What can overshadow that? And John 16:7 says, "But I tell you the truth, it is for your good." Your parents ever said that to your kid? No, this is for your own good. That's the truth, though, most of the time. And this is always true. It's for your good that I'm going away. So Jesus had to go so the Spirit could come. The counselor will not come to you. Unless I go away, the counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. Guaranteed. Talking about Christians. So are we forced to listen? Just because you're a Christian? God doesn't force us to do anything. Remember, salvation is all about what Jesus did. You can't improve on that. But being a disciple is about what we do. So we take this disciple, we become a disciple, and we become disciplers. But you can't be a discipler unless you're a disciple. Now, there are Christians that are not disciples, because disciples is what people do. We say yes, Lord, to the Word of God. It has nothing to do with salvation if you're saved. We can still ignore the Holy Spirit, even as saved people. Not good. Believe me, you're not storing up for yourselves riches in heaven when you do that. And here it says in Acts chapter 7, verse 51, "You stiff-necked people." You know, I like it that the Bible's not wishy-washy. It just says it like it is. "You stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts and ears." That means covered up. Your heart is protected. I was like that many years, even in ministry, because of what other people could hurt me. So you close your ears, you close your hearts. You're just like your fathers. This is a generational thing, man. This ain't new to us. Saying no to God is not new to us. It's been happening since Jesus was here. It's wrong. You always resist the Holy Spirit. You know, we cannot live a victorious life in Christ if we're not obedient to him. That's what we started out with. If you love me, obey me. That's truth. You are the Spirit's temple. He lives in you. 1 Corinthians 6:98, "Do you not know that your body," this body here, the thing that's going to be back to the earth, right, "is a temple of the Holy Spirit residing in us." "Who is in you, whom you have received," past tense, for somebody that's a Christian. When you get saved, you get the full measure of the Holy Spirit. God doesn't give you 25% Holy Spirit when you get saved and then add some as you mature. He gives you 100% of himself in you, and then you learn how to operate in it from there. You know? You're not your own. You've been bought and paid for, Christian. He paid for you on the cross. You don't have the authority to call the shots in your life, because you don't own yourself anymore. You signed off the title to your life to the Lord Jesus when you got saved. Let's start living like it. The Holy Spirit gives us new life. I'm sure glad of that, man. My old life was horrible. John 3, 5 and 6 says, Jesus answered, I tell you the truth, no one, there's no one left out here, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. There are not going to be any unsaved people in heaven. You can't get there. The only way of going to heaven is to be saved. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to the Spirit. This is hard stuff to swallow for people that refuse to surrender themselves to the Holy Spirit. This is bad news, man. It's good news for those who are willing to sacrifice themselves for God. Good news. I don't have to figure it out anymore. I've got the Bible. People tell me, I wish God would speak to me. I said, well, aren't you reading your Bible? It's God's word to you. The Holy Spirit shows us God's love. No one knows love except those who are saved because God is love. They have infatuation. They have all kinds of emotions, but love is God. And if you don't have him, you don't have love. Romans 5:5 says, and hope does not disappoint us. We have a hope, guys. I'm dealing with a friend of mine now who is, the doctor says he's got 6 months to live. You know, and he has lived a roller coaster life. He's saved. But now he's facing the reality that he's going to be out of here pretty soon. And I'm sending him encouraging stuff. Praise God. You only have to put up with 6 more months of this mess? And I'm jealous, man. When you think about it, if you can ever imagine what it's going to be like to be in heaven when there's no more tears and no more sorrow, why would anybody choose to add any hours to their life? No. Take me home when my time is done. Five begins. Hope does not disappoint us because God has poured out, it's past tense, his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us. In other words, if the Holy Spirit's there, if you're saved, then God has poured out his love on you. And some of us want to hold our past against us, you know. Say, man, God surely can't love me after the stuff I did. A lot of people say that. But his love is final. It's complete. The Holy Spirit empowers us for ministry. Acts chapter 1, verse 8 says, but you will receive power. I like power. I like power. I want to be equipped for what God wants me to do. I want it all. Bring it. When the Holy Spirit comes on you, when you get saved, you've got the power. You've got to learn how to use the power. Just like in building hot rods. You can have all the engine you want under the hood, but until you stomp on that throttle, you ain't going nowhere. You got to know how to use the power. And he said, and why? What's the reason for this power? And you will be my witnesses. That's why we have the power, so that we can represent our Savior out there. You will be my witnesses. That's why he gave us his Holy Spirit. In Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. In Flowery Branch, in Hall County, Georgia, and beyond. Isn't it cool that God has equipped us to speak into the lives of people all around the world? Just by this little church, The Holy Spirit teaches us what to say. Have you ever just come up with something in the spur of the moment and say, where'd that come from? Sometimes it'll be scripture that you weren't even dwelling on, but it's the right thing to say at the time. Luke 12, verses 11 and 12. When you are brought before the synagogues, rulers and authorities, and they're dragging you into court, do not worry about how you will defend yourselves or what you will say. God is speaking to Christians who are being persecuted by the law of the land. Believe me, there's a time coming when preaching the gospel is going to be a criminal offense. Don't bother me. I go to prison. There's a lot of lost people in prison. I ain't shutting up, though. For the Holy Spirit will teach you at that time. You don't need to come up with some memorized statement to tell somebody. At the right moment, the Holy Spirit will teach you what to say. That'll pierce into the hearts of people all around you. I don't know what you need, but the Holy Spirit does. And he takes my words and pierces your heart with them. All I know is I love Jesus. God knows what you need, and you will hear from the Holy Spirit what you need. Isn't that cool? And the Holy Spirit enables us to live the Christian life. We need the Holy Spirit, guys. Romans 8, 5 to 9. Those who live according to the sinful nature, those who live in unrepentant, ongoing sin, have their mind set on what that nature desires. That's why they are living in it, because that's their desire. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit of God's in you and you're saying yes, have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of sinful man is death. Thank goodness for Jesus, huh? Thank God for Jesus. But the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. So if we say yes to Holy Spirit, to the Holy Spirit, we're going to have peace. That doesn't mean we're not going to have trials. But that means we can go through them with peace, knowing that God's got us. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Unsaved people cannot surrender to God other than being saved. They can't surrender to the will of God because the Spirit's not in there to make it happen. Don't expect lost people to do right. Come on, it ain't in them. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, Christian, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit of God. Say yes to him. Say yes to the Word of God and the Scriptures. God wrote that so we won't have to guess on what to do. If the Spirit of God lives in you, if you're saved, remember we already talked about this, if you're saved, the Spirit of God is living in there, whether you acknowledge him or not. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. You know, Scripture says you'll know them by their fruit. How are we doing, church? How are we doing? Do you care enough about other people to invite them to church? And I don't mean in passing. I mean, if you're a disciple of Christ, that's all you're about. Keep talking to people. Keep inviting them to church. We've just got a little place, but I guarantee you one thing. If you guys start asking people to come and they respond, we're going to outgrow this little building. Why? So we can love more people. That's the only reason. Equip the saints. Make disciples. Disciples making disciples. Amen. Father, we're so grateful that you love us enough to write down for us in print what we need to know in order to be saved, in order to be pleasing in your eyes. Father, I pray that this word today would pierce the hearts of everyone here, that they may have some issues to deal with so they're not hindering the work that you have for them to do. Father, as we're closing down this part of our day, Lord, I pray that you would bless the offering. Lord, you always do and always meets the needs. And Father, I also pray that you'd bless our food that we're going to share together, that it would give us health and strength. Give us sweet fellowship, Father, I pray, that we'd be focused on you when we're dealing with other people. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.